My game's not up. Oh, that's not the right one. That is not the right one. That's why I chose the right. I chose the wrong format thing. Welcome everyone, and welcome to the Serious Play Lunch Zone live stream for the day. Before we get started, I'm gonna go ahead and read our land acknowledgement. So we acknowledge that in Milwaukee, we live and work on traditional Potawatomi, Ho-Chunk, and Menominee homelands along the southwest shores of the Mishigami, part of North America's largest system of freshwater lakes, where the Milwaukee, Menominee, and Kinnickinnick rivers meet, and the people of Wisconsin Sovereign, Anishinaabe, Ho-Chunk, Menominee, Oneida, and Mohican nations remain present. So I am David Kutchick, and I am a PhD student here at UW-Milwaukee in the English department. And I'm joined right now by three lovely people, so you can go ahead and introduce yourselves.
I can go first. My name is Morgan Forbush. I am a master's student in cultural anthropology at UWM as well.
My name is Janelle Malagong. I'm a second year PhD, also at UWM.
I am Ren. I'm an MA student in English at UWM, and I definitely flirted with the opening this by making Grant Kirkhope noises into the mic, but decided that would be maybe not the greatest idea.
Yeah. So, of course, now that our stream has started, my controller does not want to work. So we might get to see me adjust some controller plugin settings, which is always fun.
I'm here for it.
So while you're doing that, maybe you can introduce the game to us.
Yeah, so the game I'm playing today is called Banjo-Kazooie, The Nightbear Before Christmas. So not The Nightmare Before Christmas, but The Nightbear Before Christmas. And it is a fan game made by Kirko Mods, who's kind of a very well-known modder in the Banjo-Kazooie fan modding community online. And this is one he made for the holiday season. And I believe, I haven't played it too much, I just like messed around with it to play with the controls. And I believe it's like a mix between Banjo-Kazooie and The Nightmare Before Christmas, which should be interesting. You know what, I might just end, and I might reload. Hopefully this works.
So what controller are you using, by the way,
for this? I am using a very basic Logitech controller.
Ah, just the standard, like, $20 gamepad?
Yep.
Yeah.
Here. Oop.
I know exactly what $20 controller you're talking about.
Oh, yeah, everyone has it. Or not everyone, but everyone who wants the cheapest. So this is something that's actually good, and something I kind of want to talk about for the fan game stuff in general, is that one of the things that's kind of challenging when playing fan game stuff is just like getting all of the settings right and made in order for you to play these things. So a lot of mods use emulators. So the emulator I'm using right now is Project 64. And for older systems like the Nintendo 64 or the Super Nintendo, it is a little easier to create programs that can kind of, emulate the original system pretty well. But when you get into fan stuff, especially when you get into fan mods where they add on to content of original games, you usually have a couple of extra weird steps to get through in order to be able to play it. So like with these mods that Kirko Mods makes.
Famous modder, Grant Kirkhope.
Famous modder, Grant Kirkhope. There we go, finally working. Right, so there are some loopholes you kind of have to jump through, or hoops you have to jump through in order to get through them. So with Project 64, it doesn't like the way that he mods it. So you have to play it like the first time around. You have to bring it up. It'll give you kind of a warning saying that you can't really play it. And then you have to go through like a couple of things where you have to adjust some of the settings in the emulation part of the settings in order to be able to actually play the game, because it's different than just like the base game. And I have had to watch a lot of videos to understand how to do it. All right, so 'twas the night before Christmas, and inside the house, a bear and a bird, but nary a mouse. Banjo and Kazooie were prepping the tree, but who is that crying? They ran out to see. I love this so much. This little storybook intro is definitely something new that is not within the base game. I won't do all the voice acting, but I wanted to do that.
I love the voice acting. I'm here for it.
So, what I'm really interested in talking about today, and of course we can, like, go in whatever direction we want, but something I'm thinking about in particular is how so in fan studies, in academia, it's like kind of a knee-jerk reaction to be like, the knee-jerk reaction is to be like, oh, you know, Banjo-Kazooie was in the 90s, The Nightmare Before Christmas came out in the 90s. It's just people who really love the 90s, like, making something to be nostalgic for the 90s, right? Or be nostalgic for the Nintendo 64. And so what I'm interested in exploring is how, it's not just, like, being nostalgic, but it's, like, adding on to it, or kind of showing the creator's own ideas and how they wish or hope that the game itself could be improved or, like, reutilized in some ways. So, like, we have a couple of characters who, like, don't show up in this first level of the game. Like, this guy right here, his name is Captain Blubber, and it sounds like he's farting when he talks.
Fantastic. Gotta bring in all of that.
Yep. And so it's like, it's remixing the game, right? So it's not just being like, oh, let's take the initial setup of the game and then somehow put the Nightmare of Christmas on top of it. It's like remixing it, moving characters around in the environment. And it's adjusting some things that really only, like, experienced people who have, like, played Banjo-Kazooie would know. There's no tutorial for, like, all the moves that you learn. So, like, I can do all of, like, the more complex moves that require multiple button inputs. And this game doesn't tell you how to do them, right? There's no, like, tutorial as there is in the base game. So it kind of, you kind of see this a lot with fan games and mods, is that it's made for the audience of people who already know the game and already understand how it operates.
Right. I mean, I think, like, in the space of something like Undertale, right, you get things like Undertale Red, and those are specifically difficulty amps. Like, they're there to make the game not just have new content, but to make it, like, harder and more challenging for other players. And I guess that's modding in the tradition of, like, Kaizo Mario, right?
Yeah.
Where you mod the game so that you can make your friend real frustrated.
Yeah.
But, like, I guess the question here is, like, is this adding a new challenge to the game, or is it just adding new content to the game?
So it's not really doing either. I mean, because you could, it depends on what you think the term, like, content is. So something, what's interesting about this mod in particular is that it's just kind of a short little cutesy, I shouldn't say cutesy, but it's just, like, a short mod that doesn't have a whole lot to it. So, like, the playthrough that the creator does on YouTube for the mod is only about 30 minutes long. So it's not a terribly long mod. The same creator has made other mods that I've played that are, like, 10 hours long, where he, like, takes Ocarina of Time and Banjo-Kazooie and puts them together. So you have, like, the gameplay of Banjo-Kazooie, and he's used the engine that Banjo-Kazooie uses to recreate Ocarina of Time levels in the game. So that's, like, new content. This is using existing content within the game, such as, you know, the characters, all the enemies, all of those elements are taken directly from the game. They're just placed in this first level, which is also in the game. So it's not really a new content, it's more so, like, remixing the content and putting them in new environments to create something new. And it's also not really interested in, like, a challenge. Because the challenge doesn't really arise from, like, a new spike in difficulty. It just arises in, like, the new environments or the characters, like, being remixed. So it's kind of, like, all the same challenge level. It's just adjusted Right, it's just adjusted into new and separate or different.
It's sampling.
Yeah, yeah. But mods like can do all those things. Sorry, Janelle.
And then Bethesda can charge.
No,
what I find so, not so, but particularly interesting about this kind of mod, because obviously, like, discussion of gaming mods is a whole can of worms, right?
Yeah.
But here, one thing that's kind of interesting is that it's made using all these same assets that would have been technically available on the Nintendo 64. But it's right, no one plays this on the Nintendo 64, right? Like, you can only play this on your PC after the fact.
Yeah, definitely. And there are some modders who will, like, if you pay them, you know, like, $20 or $30 or something, they will, like, make their fan work, they will make, like, cartridges that are playable on the N64 itself. And I think it's a lot easier for, again, older game systems like the SNES or the NES. It's a lot less labor intensive, and it's a little easier to put fan work in that environment that they create. Sorry, I'm getting distracted. Right, the fan work that they create, it's a little bit easier to put into physical cartridges the further back you go. I don't know if people can make, like, GameCube discs, for example, that work on the original GameCube. I think that kind of technology is just not accessible right now. But I might be wrong.
What might you be wrong about?
You cut out a little bit.
Oh, sorry. I might be wrong. So, as far as I know, I think the cutoff for, like, fans creating physical cartridges or discs cut off around the N64 era. I'm not sure if the technology is available to make, like, discs. So if you modded something like...
Because it's specifically DRM, I think.
Yeah. So if you modded something like Wind Waker, for example, I think there's Wind Waker mods out there, but I don't know if the technology is available to create discs that you can use in the GameCube.
Yeah.
I also think it's an emulation, because a lot of these mods are made in emulation, and there's not a lot of, like, Xbox 360 or Xbox original emulation current. If I understand the current technology area.
There's, so, like, maybe, PS2, though.
Yeah. But I can imagine that there's just not the need to make the discs, because there's not a lot of mods coming out for them, because there's not a lot of...
And there's probably just not a lot of demand for that.
It's a really bizarre...
Go ahead.
It's a really bizarre graph when you lay it out, though, right? Because you get... cartridges, or you get that slope of cartridges where there's a really large amount of mods for this space, then it's at the beginning of kind of disc-based systems goes away, and then you come back and now you have mods that in an all-digital environment, because it's an all-digital environment, that where you download hundreds of mods, the community is kind of exploded in certain places. To the point of talking about GameCube stuff in particular, I'm not sure what you would need to, like, get an optical drive that would, like, burn to GameCube. Like, I'm not sure, what, like, if there's any difference there or what.
I mean, some tech enthusiast probably knows exactly how to do it. You know what I mean? But it's not necessarily very accessible. Right?
And
they're all like deep.
I mean, not that making a Nintendo 64 cartridge seems accessible to me right now.
Yeah, so
I would think cartridges are harder than DVDs to burn, but that might just be my brain in the digital mode instead of the analog mode.
Yeah, it's hard because I myself am not completely versed in all of this either, so I don't know the nuts and bolts of it, which is also a Banjo-Kazooie game. But it's interesting, right, that there are people who are willing to put in the effort to create something like, you know, a physical cartridge and learn that. And there is, like, economically viable options, not in terms of, like, making a profit, but just in terms of, like, providing somebody with a physical cartridge, and basically, like, not risking financial ruin by making it yourself. It's interesting that the development of the technology has come that far.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
and it's not too labor intensive for some people to justify doing.
Yeah.
So I actually contributed to a mod this week.
Ooh.
Which is a first. It's not like this is a normal occurrence for me. As some of you might recall, I think this one was on the blog. I made a video about Doom 64, which actually has a pretty robust, it's another Nintendo 64 game, actually, incidentally, which has a pretty robust modding scene, I guess. And so somebody was making a mod and reached out to me and asked if I would help come up with, like, the Doom series is kind of known for mocking the player when they die, and they asked me to come up with a line or two to mock the player when they die because I had made this video and they wanted my input. So I think the line that I gave him was, back to the drawing board, too bad you can't draw, or something like that. But yeah, so, and then they uploaded like a demo of it, and my there I am, error, in the game, mocking you.
That's really
that's so cool
for your YouTube channel, right?
I do think it illuminates a little bit the playfulness of these kind of mods, right? They're playing with the franchise, with the rules set in place, right? These are people who like Banjo-Kazooie, presumably, and want more, right? And are making more of it in their own little playful way.
Yeah, and the playfulness is really apparent when you I'm thinking of something kind of the combination Banjo-Kazooie Ocarina of Time game that I mentioned before. They put a lot of Easter eggs in that really you'd only understand, right, if you're like a player of the game. So like you maybe have to know how to use a certain move for a certain element within the environment in order to find these secrets, and like you need to be really well versed in the game to understand that, and that's something that films like fans and that kind of stuff, right, references in jokes and that kind of thing, that's something that's definitely carried over into the modding community, right? Because fan communities in general all have those things that they that if you're in on the joke, right, you get it. I want to know, has anybody like else in the chat ever played either a mod or a fan game? Like, that isn't... I'm thinking of something that exists, like, outside of, like, a sanctioned mod on Steam.
I've played my fair share... Oh, excuse me. Give me a sec. I had to clear my throat. I've played my fair share of Minecraft mods, which has always been a very robust community. They have, like... I think Minecraft has, at this point, like, 3 mod loaders. And so I've played my fair share of, like, Minecraft mods, and people also make...
Oh, Morgan, you cut out for me for a second. And it's possible my internet just sucks. But could you just say that again?
Sure. I've done my fair share of Minecraft modding. Not my I've played Minecraft mods. And there's, like, this huge maker community of mods in Minecraft. There's people who just don't play vanilla Minecraft, they only play mods. Mm-hmm. And I remember when Mojang got sold to Microsoft, everyone was really worried that Microsoft was going to crack down on the mods and not allow that community to still exist. And I remember, I think Dinnerbone or Notch, one of them, was just like very specific about, no, the modding community is still going to happen because Java exists. And as long as Java exists, modding will exist. Bedrock, not so much, but as long as the original version of Minecraft exists, you can mod it to your door. So it's kind of it's a developer-sanctioned modding community, which I just think is really cool how they allow that to flourish and such. But yeah. I don't know about other people.
Yeah, Eric, you had mentioned you had done some Kaizo stuff.
I've just played some Kaizo mods. Nothing too serious. Just kind of dipping my toe in the water to get a feel for it. But I mean, I like difficult games, as you guys know. the whole speedrunning thing. But yeah, I think I'm trying to think if I've played a full-on fan mod, like, through completion. And I'm coming up blank right now. I have played Black Mesa.
Black Mesa is fantastic.
That's sanctioned, though. That's super sanctioned.
Right, but a lot of what got Steam popular was taking... And this is something that I think is also interesting, and when I, like, go to do my full show, it's kind of what I want to investigate some more, is, like, how have companies, like, mined some of these and maybe, like, manipulated or taken some of these ideas from these mods or the modding communities and utilized them for their own profit, which I think you could argue Steam has done in several occasions.
Or Valve in general, because... So, like, there's been, like, Dota was a fan game that got made into a real game. So was Team Fortress.
Mm-hmm.
So those are two really popular ones that come to mind.
Portal is not, like, a modded game that became, like, popular, but it is, like, a remix of what you can do with that engine, you know?
Wasn't it kind of like the developers messing around and they decided just to put it in a game?
Yeah.
No.
That's kind of... No? I don't know the full story, but that's kind of how...
Portal was actually a college project by a college game design team, and then Valve just bought them. And then, and like, because, like, they had the prototype for the Portal thing, and they were like, this could be a good game. We're going to buy you and your project and make it into, like, a Valve property. That's the original history of Portal.
It worked out, I hope.
Can I just say, this is, again, such a stupid or, like, basic funny plot. It's just like, Gruntilda tricked you into letting her into town so she can get Christmas lights because she wants to... She wants her lair to look nice. Right, so, like, mods can, you know, it, just like any other game, right? It can range from, like, a challenge to just telling a silly story. Something that I thought was interesting that Doc Strange just mentioned was that this idea that mods are somehow scavenging or kind of pulling games that maybe are abandoned or lost and putting new life into them, which I think is an interesting idea, especially when you consider something like... a franchise like Banjo-Kazooie, where it's kind of common knowledge, you know, Microsoft bought Rare in the early 2000s and kind of ran it into the ground. And so you have, like, original developers from Rare go make, you know, Yooka-Laylee or that kind of stuff. So it definitely fits that model, right, of, like, there was something cool or unique about how Rare made their games and Nintendo and Microsoft kind of ruined it. So that's an interesting idea that I think works well with this example.
Yeah, that reminds me of a quote from Tim Rogers' review of Tokimeki Memorial, where he's talking about Konami, because Konami's like a dead company. I mean, it's not dead, but they just make
gotcha machines
or whatever. So he references Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night, which is made by Castlevania developers, and like because he's kind of talking to people who would want Konami to make a new Castlevania game or a new Metal Gear Solid game or something like that. Say, like, those people are gone. It's like, even if the company made those, like, the people who made them the great are not that, right? If you want a sequel to Castlevania, you need to play Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night. Like, that's closer to a sequel because that's what the people who actually made the game are doing. And that, what you just described with Yooka-Laylee, is kind of like that too. And that's unfortunately kind of the sad reality of, like, these, of the IP stuff, right? Or the way intellectual property works, it's like, well, you can't make a Castlevania game if you're not Konami, if you don't have the rights. And so, but the thing is the thing that makes those games special is the people who made them, right? Not necessarily the company or the IP itself.
And I think a good example of that, who made Portal, most of the actual developers at Valve have moved on to other projects because they've shifted focus. And he's like, wait, so that means I might not get, like, another, like, a Portal game? Like, probably not, and it's probably, if you do get it, it won't be as good as you want it to be. And he's like, oh, okay. Which really, he was really sad about it, because it is true that the developers when you have developers who leave and go do other things, you lose that the spark of certain projects. And
to be fair, Valve did make the best game of 2020.
What was it, Alex?
Alex is so phenomenal. We don't need to talk about it. That's not what this time is about.
I'm just saying that a lot of the original people who made Valve's original games are mostly moved on to different projects.
Or right. Just like Gabe Newell doesn't really care about game design. He's like about pushing technology, right? He's like a John Carmack more than he is like a John Romero.
Yeah. That's bringing it back to id. Always back to Doom.
I'll never shy away from a chance to praise John Carmack. You know, the other thing that's interesting about this stuff is you pretty much invariably get into the conversation that's plagued Silent Hill fans for the longest time, right? Which is, you know, this myth of Team Silent. That there was this contingent group of people at Konami making Silent Hill games. You know, this is somewhat true, but the team that made Silent Hill 1 wasn't exactly the same as the team that made Silent Hill 2, wasn't exactly the same as the team that made Silent Hill 3, and most of them were gone by the time of Silent Hill 4. You know, 4, of course, is kind of the dark horse of the set, but, you know, it's... And, you know, we can actually kind of maybe make some jokes about whether 3 or not is... it fits the category of a mod hilariously, since it mostly repurposes assets from Silent Hill 2, despite being an entirely new game in the same engine.
Same thing with Majora's Mask.
Yeah, so, you know, you get these kind of blendings, but I mean, PT, you know, headed by Kojima, fantastic game. It seems very different than the regular Silent Hills, but there. And there have been, from what I understand, some Silent Hill fan projects that have been pretty good. It's... the essential quality of, like, what makes a game series doesn't seem to me to be entirely located within just the people who made it, but it does seem to be something that is lost when that team moves on. At the very least, a faith in the studio to produce the experience again, right? BioWare has had this same issue recently, where, you know, because of EA stuff, and maybe just because people want to move on, they've walked away from these things, and then, you know, the games keep coming out, and people are like, well, is this even the same BioWare that made Mass Effect 2?
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, this is kind of just the natural consequence of that, you know...
And, like, you know, I think there's this, you know, the industry pushes forward, but people are like... people are often kind of somewhat looking backward and then saying to themselves, you know, well, I want this game again, but I don't want to just play this game over and over again. And obviously, you know, mods begin to fill that niche.
It's like, I want more of the stuff. I don't want different stuff. I just want more of it.
Yeah. Sonic Mania. Back to Sonic Mania.
Sonic Mania.
Well, and what's interesting, so that, you know, all this conversation's got me thinking about, oh my gosh, they're... in this little area here, they're using the ladder from Ocarina of Time. Nice little touch there. Something that's interesting to me, too, is the connection to game developers, right? Or at least the aura of game developers in fans of video games, I think is something that I haven't thought about before. Because most of my work has focused on things like Pokemon, where it's like a larger studio, and maybe the heads of them are the most known people. But I think something like Banjo-Kazooie or Silent Hill, right, where you have these people like Grant Kirkhope, who's a character, or Kojima, who's kind of this larger-than-life character too, that brings in an interesting layer to it as well. There's kind of this yearning for the aura of that creator to be infused in the fan project as well, which I think is an interesting addition to it that I hadn't thought about before.
Yeah. And it's kind of, bringing it back to Final Fantasy XIV. Final Fantasy XIV has a developer, Yoshida, I don't remember his last name, but we call him Yoshi P. He's endeared himself to the community so much that he got... when he does live letters and stuff, everyone tunes in to say, oh, what is Yoshi P going to tell us what's going on with the games? And there's very much a persona of, this is Yoshi P's game, and we're just here for the ride. And when it was announced that he was on Final Fantasy 16, a lot of people were like, wait, Does that mean that Yoshi's not going to be on Final Fantasy 14 anymore? And what does that mean for the game? Will it be Final Fantasy 14 without Yoshi P? Like, what do we do? Sort of thing. So I can kind of see that the aura of specific developers tied so closely to games.
Well, and this gets into another, like, I think really huge question, right? Like, certainly there is an effect that an individual director will have on a game, right? Or a composer will have on a game. I mean, Kiriyami Oka can be said, it can be said Kiriyami Oka is working on a project and people in Silent Hill get really excited about that. And most of the time, by the time the game comes out, his work isn't actually in it. So there's this thing... I think Barth probably would have referred to it as kind of the author god, right? That, like, to some degree, people expect and preserve. As far as who is really making these choices. But in the case of Kojima Productions or something, you have a whole group of devs who are there to, like, create the feeling of a Kojima game. With or without Kojima.
Well, I think all of this points to, you know, some really long-standing and big questions in social theory, which are not even just restricted to, you know, artistic production or the notion of the author or anything like that. And that is the relationship between individual performative agency and a sponsoring institution. You know, what Shalipak Moore talks about it, a lot of the stuff we read about in performance theory, the struggle to sort of understand and appreciate what accounts for or to what we should attribute something that generates meaning, right? Is it the individual genius, you know, whether it be of a chef or a game designer or a novelist, or is it a system around them, a set of investments over time that has produced a cultural institution that has sustained in its own way certain kinds of reliable mechanisms for generating things that are compelling? The latter is generally suffers. You know, we tend to produce this idea that, well, no, it's so-and-so, it's the special person that has to account for it. We're less likely, I think, to trust, at least in these kind of modern individualist times, the sponsoring institution as being the thing that we can count on.
I think that approach to creation also really benefits game companies and their ability to overwork the laborers, you know, like the debuggers and just like the lowly peon or whatever you want to call them, right? By kind of engaging in the idea of like this brilliant creator leading the team, right? You're able to justify some of the labor practices that aren't really beneficial for the everyday worker. In some ways, at least. Because you're able to focus on the creator rather than the process.
It also, yeah, and it feeds into a whole bunch of things about marketing and all the rest, because, you know, it's easier to market around a special person than an institution in many ways. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of things support, I think, that kind of lionization of particular individual or individual genius.
Can I bring in Scorsese? Because this is actually pretty much what Scorsese's essay was about that he published yesterday.
Please.
So Scorsese releases this essay yesterday. This is better than the superhero one. And note, I'm one of those people who actually kind of like the superhero one. but anyways... in Scorsese's essay, he's talking about Federico Fellini, you know, famous Italian director, proponent, or, you know, helps popularize neorealism and stuff like that in world cinema, worldwide cinema, I mean, not like world cinema, the genre. And so Scorsese's writing about... Specifically, he kind of is like trying to reclaim this word cinema from the clutches of the kind of concept of content. He's got a problem with the word content because it kind of treats the artistic object as, you know, as just this like marketable thing, right? To like sell a subscription service or something. And he notes that he, ooh, that's a great shot.
I know, right? Somebody screenshot that.
And so in it, he kind of dives into the artistry of the cinema of Fellini, and he kind of makes this argument that that's worth preserving, like that idea of artistry. But it's so wound up in this individualist kind of understanding of cinema and how it's made and what it means. And of course, I don't mean to be overly critical of Scorsese, because as I said, I thought it was a good read. Like, whether or not I agree with him, I thought it was a really good read. But of course, it's Scorsese, another director, right, mm-hmm. who would say these things about Fellini, because it reinforces his own identity as a special creator type, right? And so when I was reading it, I did get that feeling of like, well, what about all of like the people who collaborated with Fellini, right? Like the costume design department, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? Who aided in the creation of these. Like, exactly. To hear Scorsese tell the story, it's almost like those people are an afterthought. And I don't know. I don't know if they are. I think it's a little more complicated than that. He does try to make this kind of Kubrickian argument that Kubrick was like in control of every aspect of like the film, right?
Kubrick was, I guess.
I guess, but I just think that that's a simplification for the sake of making an argument.
I do think so. And you look at, like, there are certain movies that, like, you look at the little movies, and I'm going to Marvel because that's the one that comes to mind. Like, watching the behind the scenes of the costume design of Captain America, like, the director didn't have anything really to say about what Captain America looked like, but the costume designer's like, no, we wanted the stitching, we wanted this very specific look, we had this very particular way we wanted Captain America to look like. And there's a lot of passion there. And that helped, you know, sell the character of Captain America, and the director didn't really do anything with it except maybe sign off on it. So it's this idea of, I don't think having it like an afterthought is necessarily all there is to the creative process of making like films.
Yeah, and something,
as many of you have gotten tired of hearing me say, you know, one of the most persistent human tendencies is the tendency to lose perspective, right? And maybe no one more so than people who are in a position to feel that their creative input is the secret sauce to everything, right? And liable to have a distorted picture of the agency that they have in making one thing or another happen.
Something that's like, sorry, Aaron, you can go.
Oh, okay, for sure. I was gonna just like to poke at the things that you know, D&D and ARGs and these sorts of places where you, or performance art, where you have like live improvisation happening, right? With maybe a crew of people, maybe a single person, depending on what kind of production you're dealing with, right? When the production is happening in real time, the creation of the art is always, always ever changing, the interpretation of the art, the moment of the art. So there's so little of a distinction between, you know, these spaces of, you know, authorship and community. What's interesting is when you make a space like that, the production team becomes, in a lot of ways, unavoidable. Now you can create a veil, you can put up the DM screen, you can hide behind all this mediated content. The fan community will suss it out. They always suss it out. It seems to me that's a matter of, like, you know, your real-time kind of broadcast space. Pulling back into cinema, and this is something that I think is interesting that maybe Scorsese is also kind of ignoring when we're talking about the origin of terms, right? Like, where is the current explosion of the word content coming from? I don't think it's coming from streaming services. I think, from in my experience, it has grown out of the YouTube community.
He says it kind of started there, and then, and like, I think he's thinking from like a perspective of like him having like, I don't know, like a meeting with an Amazon executive, and then them calling what he makes content, right? Like,
that's like an insult, man.
and that's kind of what he's kind of engaging with. It's kind of funny that he really front loads the essay, because he makes that argument like in the first two paragraphs and then doesn't even address it again for like the next 12. Like,
well, and what I think is interesting, so Ren and I
I was just gonna say, Ryan asked what kind of controller you're using, and I wanted to ask that verbally because I don't know if you're checking chat.
Oh, yep. I am using a Logitech. The cheapest one you can get at a place like Target. I don't know the exact number.
It's probably like G72 or something.
Yeah. Something that Ren and I are... we're in a class about TV, media, cinema, convergence stuff. And something we read was how... one of the books we read called Visible Fictions talks about how when you buy a ticket for the movies, you not only buy a ticket to see the individual film, but you buy a ticket for the concept of cinema itself. And it seems like Scorsese isn't really arguing that there shouldn't be a conception of cinema. He's arguing that the conception of cinema should be that director-oriented outlook. Good.
You cut out for a bit there, David. Can you
repeat the end of that.
Oh, yeah. So he's not... Sorry, so Scorsese's not saying, like... He's trying to redefine what cinema means, right? And he's saying other people are trying to maybe portray it as content or whatever. He's saying cinema is creative geniuses creating art. Like, that's what he's saying cinema is. And that's how we should conceptualize it in the popular imagination. And by doing so, we'll recapture what cinema is supposed to, quote-unquote, be. That's how I read it.
Yeah. So I want to quickly also follow up the point I was, you know, talking about content. Yeah, I don't dispute that production companies have picked up this term and you know, Amazon's changed its meaning to some degree. All I'm saying is historically, if we're looking at the origin of this term, it was mostly designed to refer to, like, you know, essentially participatory online media.
And I will say, in the modern day of YouTube, it's not... When someone says content, they go, oh, that's content, in a very ironic way of the fact that they make content out of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And a point that I'd kind of like to talk about maybe is the idea of content in video games, because live services are very focused on saying, we will have content, this is the roadmap of content. They're not necessarily saying, like, these are new cool things that you're going to really enjoy, it's, there's going to be new stuff every month, and here's the content of this live service, you should buy it. So, it's kind of recontextualizing it a little bit. Like, well, we're making a lot of content for this video game.
There is something really corporate in the word, I think. I also have, like, persistently wondered, since we're talking about the word content a little bit now, whether or not the term came from the creators first or from YouTube first, because I don't recall hearing it before Google bought out YouTube.
Well, Google bought out YouTube like a year before YouTube was even big, so that's not really good.
That's a little revisionist. Yeah. Just because it got bigger doesn't mean it wasn't huge. It was bought for billions of dollars as a tech company and the recession.
It was bought in 2006, so not during the recession.
Was it 2000? I thought
it was bought. So YouTube was founded in 2005. It was bought by YouTube in mid to late 2006. So it was bought by YouTube very quickly.
But was Ren? Because that was Ren, I think. Ren, were you asking the question? Where does the term of referring to things in terms of content come from? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I mean, I would love to know if there's history of it.
I mean, my feeling about it. Not, I mean, I haven't worked this all out or seen anyone work it all out, but I think that in really, really important ways, the language of engineering, in a deep historical way, and then more locally in its computer engineering, or what we call computer science form, generated the distinction between content and that which is kind of architecture or platform or any word you might choose that has seeped into the public discourse. That would be my first thought about that.
I think something, just for the last 10 minutes of the thing, I think this is something we could touch on. Ludo Scholar mentioned a little bit ago is, like, with this discussion of the creative genius, then it seems like a lot of modern communities are more focused on the community aspect rather than the individual genius, right? So I'm thinking of something like Pokemon Essentials, which is a package of software that has been, like, crowdsourced to be able for anyone to, like, really easily implement it into RPG Maker. So does fan culture kind of go against that notion of the creative genius, or is it just operating in a different way? That's something I think is interesting that I also haven't thought of before. So that's a great question.
I think that's a really good... go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think we're in a much, much bigger, broader societal moment transition where we are shrugging off the fascination with individuals, the fetishization of individual creation and individual genius and virtuosity, etc.
Yeah.
And reacquainting ourselves with what communities are and what our social encumbrances are and where they come from and how inescapable they are. So I think we're seeing it right now. It's happening in the last, you know, number of years and going forward.
Yeah, I would agree with that. My own personal experience watching people play like challenging maps on Minecraft, it always happens that at the beginning they go, hey, like, Seth Bling made this map, but this person, Zisto, that person helped me test it, this person helped me NC edit. Like, they shout out every single person that helped them on this map, even as little. So I feel like that is that diffusion of, yeah, well, this guy, I just said Seth Bling because I came up right. Seth Bling started the map, but all these people helped finish the map and make the map what it is. So I think that is that diffusing of creative minds into a community, which is good, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think there are some mods that are still, or modders that are still held as, like, virtuosos. Like, those things I don't think are totally going away. I want to be optimistic about the death of that idea that, you know, one person makes a thing and it is inescapably their thing. Because I think that's just a helpful thing. Like, especially in an ARG community, God, I would kill to not have people immediately dismiss things out of hand because, you know, oh, well, you know, but in an interview outside of the game, the author said this. It's like, okay, guys, come on. We can get past this. Especially since there are like 6 people working on this damn project. You don't need to just listen to the guy who was narrating everything. I guess I'm, what the heck is going on, David?
Oh, I tried to, I think I need to transform into a pumpkin to get into that hole, but I was like, maybe not, and I tried swimming through there. Because right now I'm just like looking for new areas I haven't explored yet, and I'm coming up short, so I'm just trying everything right now.
Huh. Okay. My train of thought was disrupted, and now my brain is...
I would agree that there's probably never going to be a time where virtuistic, like, oh, this person is virtuous.
Thanks for coming, Thomas. It was great.
Bye. A virtuoso. I don't think virtuosos will ever not exist. But I definitely think it's gonna be. It could lead to like a lesson virtuoso effect.
Yeah.
Everyone
I guess,
is idle.
What is? What is? Oh, sorry. Ren, you go.
Oh no! Please, David.
I was going to say, what's interesting, too, is that there's a lot of fan cultures that are like, really against the creative genius that created the object. Harry Potter's one of them, right, in the news right now. But but things like Joss Whedon now, too, right, where, yet again, there's another story about how he's been really awful to women who are on his TV shows. Right, and so like there are these fandoms where it's like the creative genius that has been created, like in the Hollywood or popular imagination, is directly being contradicted, which I think is another interesting addition to it.
And I think it's kind of like when you like get, I feel like what fandoms do. This is simplification. It's like they get to a point where they realize that their parents aren't perfect, and then they have to grapple with the fact that their parents aren't angels, sort of thing. Like when you get to your 20s and you move out and you realize your parents did stuff, and you're like, oh, my parents aren't these perfect people that I thought they were. I feel like that's what a lot of fandoms come up against, especially with like Joss Whedon and people who made these cult classics that are not angels of people, angels, yeah. Human angels. So it's. I have a hard time separating like music artists from their work. So if like a musical artist is terrible, I will more likely pirate their music than pay them money to listen to it. But like for movies and stuff, I have a harder time. Like they're not quite connected to me as much. I don't know.
This is like, you know, I think this is, you know, I always say a stupid amount about poetry, but you know, poets, there's an old like kind of adage that there is no such thing as a good person who is also a poet, or they're all awful in some way, otherwise they wouldn't be poets. And I mean, obviously there are some people who more embody this than others. A lot of the people who do embody this are people like T.S. Eliot or Ezra Pound, who, you know, end up being fascists by the end of their lives. This is to say that, you know, this question of, like, where does the ethical line draw and how does digital culture change the ethical line, I think is a really important one, too. Because, like, it's one thing to say, well, you know, Lovecraft was one of probably the discreetest, shittiest people on planet Earth. In terms of his beliefs, but like, damn, that's some good fiction when he's dead. But you know, when J.K. Rowling is alive and railing on Twitter, I mean, what do you do with that? And I think in the question of, like, you know, our fan communities really, you know, moving towards this community-based approach to authorship and really embodying it, there's a question of, like, does it just become how's the ethical responsibility distributed around the team, you know? Mm-hmm. We run into this issue in Discord communities often now, where mods for those communities will end up being pedophiles, child groomers, you know? Mm-hmm. Does that sink the whole server? It's killed more than one that I've seen, you know? And there's suspicion on the other mods because, you know, it's hard to imagine that they wouldn't have known that sometimes, even if, you know, they wouldn't have.
Yeah, you see that with, like, creator groups. I'm thinking, like, Normal Boots or Channel Awesome. It's like, how complacent are the people? What is your role in the complacency sort of thing?
Yeah.
Were you complacent, or did you just not know about it? But I think that gets kind of away from the community games aspect. But it's still important.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like, I don't know. I mean, there's also the question of, like, what happens when a community game is made. We have, like, 3 minutes left. But when it's made specifically to improve the game, right? There's this, like Cyberpunk. Since so many mods have come out, because Cyberpunk is objectively a pretty... I mean, there's no such thing as an objectively bad game. But if there were one, Cyberpunk would be in the running. They've released some mods to make changes to the game, you know, to improve the driving, to give it some visual effects. But the developer also, you know, accidentally didn't program a fix for an issue in the game that would allow hackers to infiltrate your computer and infiltrate CD Projekt Red systems, right? So that presents, I think, a really weird ethical question around, you know, building mods for the game right now until that fix is made, and also a really weird ethical question around, like, what is the responsibility of a company or a production team to their modding community?
Mm-hmm. Well, it also sparks the question of, like, there are so many mods that make Bethesda games less buggy, more playable, etc., etc. And then, I do not know the full story, but Bethesda kind of went, well, we like your mods, but we're going to put them on our own, like, launcher, and you're going to have to, like, yeah.
Eight mods!
Yeah, and then everyone got really angry, and Bethesda stopped doing that, because...
It's a horrible idea!
Yeah. So, but it was one of those things where Bethesda went, oh, well, we have these really great games, and they're not really making, you know, we can port Skyrim so much, but we can sell Skyrim so many times, and once that Skyrim's sold, we don't get any residual revenue, so why don't we just make that residual revenue mods sort of thing. I feel like there's that capitalistic want for continually. But I think it's time to sign off, or David can give us some concluding words.
Yeah, I'm sad because I almost completely finished the game, but I think I'm just going to be a little bit short. But thanks, everybody, for coming and talking. I think it's been a really great conversation.
Yeah.
And at 1 o'clock, there's going to be a new episode of D&DMs coming out, so stay tuned for that. Bye.
Bye. Bye.